Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all for this debate. We welcome Honorable Mr. Justice A.K. Sikri, our chief guest and moderator for the day. Justice Sikri is a product of Delhi University. He was a topper and earned a gold medal during his law studies. In law practice, he specialized in matters concerning constitution, labor law, service matters, and arbitration. Delhi High Court designated him a senior in 1997, became a judge of Delhi High Court 2 years later, and 12 years later, he served as its acting Chief Justice before moving to Punjab and Haryana High Court as its Chief Justice. And a year later, he was elevated to the Supreme Court. Particularly, I'd like to mention four of his judgments that are etched in history. These pertain to Aadhaar card, passive euthanasia, the matter pertaining to firecrackers, and the Karnataka elections case that pertained to live proceedings flow test. He is now an international judge of Singapore International Commercial Court. Apart from moderating today's debate, he will also be delivering the 7th Palkhiwala lecture. We welcome Mr. Raju Ramachandran. He was designated as a senior advocate by Supreme Court in 1996. 2002, he was appointed Additional Solicitor General of India. He has appeared as a counsel before three very important, significant committees. The first one pertained to the charges against Justice Ramaswamy. In the second one, he stood up for the state of Kerala before the Kaveri water dispute matter. And the third one was Justice R.S. Pathak's inquiry committee on Volcker report. He's also been an amicus in two very well-known cases. The first one was an appeal in the case of Ajmal Kassab, and the second one was relating to Gulbarga Society matter that pertained to 2002 Gujarat riots. It is noteworthy that he donated his entire fees for the family members of those security personnel killed in 2611 anti-terror operation, and such an act of magnanimity on his part was described by the Supreme Court as one of high professional ethics. We greet and welcome Mr. Aravind Datar, a senior advocate and an eminent jurist. He was designated a senior by the Madras High Court in 1999. Now, with over 30 years of law practice before the various constitutional courts, he is a well-known authority on tax, company, and constitutional matters. His voluminous works and commentaries on the Central Excise Law, Constitution, the Companies Act, and apart from the later editions of Kanga and Palkhiwala's Law and Practice of Income Tax, are well-known. He has appeared before the Supreme Court in several landmark cases, including Vodafone Income Tax Matter, National Tax Tribunal Matter, SEBI Sahara Case, and the NJAC Appointment of Judges Matter. Mr. Ramachandran is being assisted by Mr. Shankar Narayanan. He graduated from NUJS Kolkata 2011, completed his Master of Laws from University College London 2016. Until very recently, he was the Senior Resident Fellow leading the Public Law Vertical at the Vidhi Center for Legal Policy. Mr. Datar is being assisted by Advocate Gautam Bhatia, an alumnus of National Law School of India University and later of University of Oxford on a Rhodes Scholarship and the Yale Law School. He's now reading for his PhD at the University of Oxford, and he's authored a very important work titled Offense, Shock or Disturb, Freedom of Speech Under the Indian Constitution and the Transformative Constitution. His work has already been cited by the Supreme Court and the High Courts of Kerala and Bombay. We are gathered here for the Rani Palkhiwala debate during the birth centenary year. Mr. Palkhivala's contribution as a front-ranking lawyer in India for over two decades, and Mr. Datar aptly titled his work on Palkhivala as courtroom genius, a reputed jurist, impressionable orator, a writer who earned great admiration, a dynamic corporate leader, eminent diplomat, activist, and philanthropist, finds hardly any equal. Speaking of him after the review of Keshwanand Bharti case, Justice H.R. Khanna had remarked that the level of his advocacy had seldom been equaled and never surpassed in the history of the Supreme Court. Such a view is valid even today. Those of you who came little earlier, you would have seen the slides here of the six lectures and other activities that have taken place so far as part of Nani Palkhivala birth centenary year. The format for today's lecture, this will see, it's actually a debate amongst two legal giants. Now, purposely, this was designed and organized so that the law students, the junior advocates, those aspiring to be in judiciary, etc., get to see how to present an argument in the setting of a court of law within a given time frame on a matter that has been decided, where you can marshal your thought, arrange in a sequence, cite proper precedences, capacity to think on feet, respond to court questions. All that you will see today. We are very happy that LexisNexis India page is having it covered live on the Facebook so that a much bigger audience can see it for the years and decades ahead. And this debate, as I said, is being covered by LexisNexis, India Legal, So Legal, and various other channels. I would now request Justice Sikri to kindly take over. He will briefly explain the rules and then proceed with the Palkhivala debate. Thank you.
We, of course, everybody knows the purpose and why we have assembled here is that we are celebrating the centenary birth celebrations of the greatest, one of the greatest lawyers, or it may be described as the greatest lawyer which Independence India has produced, Mr. Palkhivala, Nani Palkhivala. And there have been series of lectures already given by different persons and luminaries in these celebrations. But today, it's a totally different methodology which is adopted. And as Major General said in his opening remarks, that the purpose is to ensure and tell and rather educate the students as to how lively debates can be in the court when such issues are debated upon. The topic or the case which is chosen was the case which was argued by Mr. Palkhivala in the Supreme Court, in which he succeeded as well. It became a subject matter of great debate. There was an ongoing debate even on those times. Let me tell you, in 70s, the debates in the newspaper or medias were not like which are today, that on every case of a moment you will find the media, the newspapers, the channels in the news channels in the evening would be debating on those topics. There was no such kind of debates those days, as we remember. But still, as far as this case is concerned, it had generated a lot of debate. And I go back to my college days. Mr. Raju Ramachandran was, I think, 1 year or 2 years, 1 year senior to me, maybe. And when this system of case law method was introduced, which are normally known as the first generation reforms in the legal education, that if you want to teach the students, it should not be theoretical that only books are read, but the judgment should also be read, because in the judgment the judge has described, whosoever has authored the judgment, that what was argued by the petitioner, what was argued by the respondent, and then why the judge is not agreeing with the one party and why the judge is agreeing with the other party. So that rationality, that reasoning, that process comes, which may not be there in the textbooks. And it helped us a lot, if I may say so frankly. So therefore, here is a case where we go back to 1970-71, when the case was being argued in the Supreme Court, and the two lawyers are arguing that case of Privy Purse. And it is, since it is in the form of a debate and not the argument in that sense, although these are the arguments also would be there in that manner. And so this is the object, that who gives the convincing argument. And at the end of the day, I know the role of the judge, or here the moderator when I am sitting, is going to be more difficult when the two stalwarts are arguing, and I know both of them are going to argue it so forcefully that becomes difficult to see who is right, who is wrong, and which way to go. But that is the function of judges in any case. Fortunately, I don't have to decide. I have only to moderate. And as far as rules are concerned, that Mr. Raju Ramachandran is speaking for the petitioner. This petition has been filed challenging the abolition of Privy Purses, and Mr. Datar would be then replying. Of course, they have two assisting counsel. They would also be speaking in rebuttal at that time. So that time is allotted for both of them. First, you are arguing? I think, yeah, here it is, I think, wrongly mentioned. It is reversed, okay. So 15 minutes are given to Mr. Raju Ramachandran to complete his argument. Then for 15 minutes, reply would be given by Mr. Datar. Then rebuttal would be by the junior counsels for 7 minutes each. Then there would be questions, can be put by the moderator. Then questions can be put, two questions would be, because for paucity of time, we will not be able to receive more than two questions, but two questions from the audience would be received. If you want, during this period, you can write that question and give it to us. Then from that, if there are more than two questions, we can choose which are the two best questions, and those questions can be put to the speakers. So with this introduction, I now call upon Mr. Raju Ramachandran to open his arguments.
I rise to speak in support of the motion that the final outcome in the Privy Purses case was a constitutional betrayal. I lay stress on the words "the final outcome." And so we are dealing with a time span from 1972 to 1994, starting with Madhav Rao Sindhya and ending with Raghunath Rao Ganpat Rao. Mr. Moderator, sir, let us remember that when the Union of India came into being, 48% of the area of today's Indian Union and 28% of the population of the Indian Union was under the princely states of India. And these princely states voluntarily acceded to the Indian Union to give us the Union of India, in which we have grown, thrived, and prospered. There was no violence. It was a bloodless revolution. And what was the very small price which was paid by the people of India through their constitution for this bloodless revolution? It was a constitutional guarantee of Privy purses based on a fraction of the annual revenue of the respective princely states. The rulers were entitled to nothing else except their privy purses, their gun salutes, and the pomp and ceremony associated with their erstwhile role. They had given up their territories, large cash balances to make this union possible. And Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, whom we revere today, speaking in the Constituent Assembly, presciently thought of a possible betrayal, and he cautioned the Constituent Assembly that any reneging on these promises would amount to a betrayal, reneging on solemn promises. This is the compact on the basis of which our fledgling republic grew. Sometime in 1967, sir, many of these erstwhile princes joined the erstwhile Swatantra Party, which was a party ideologically opposed to the ruling Congress Party. And so the then government started a move, the government and the ruling party, that these privy purses must be done away with, that it was an anachronism. The real motivation was that the princes were on a side which was antagonistic to the ruling party. Thus began a chain of events. Please note a couple of dates. On 2nd September 1970, the government of the day moved a constitution amendment bill to do away with the privy purses. This bill was passed by the Lok Sabha. On the 5th of September, 3 days later, the bill was introduced in the Rajya Sabha, where it was defeated because the ruling party could not command the requisite majority. Please note that date, 5th of September 1970. That very night, when the President of India was in his camp station at Hyderabad, an order was passed by the President purporting to be under Article 366, 22 of the Constitution, purporting to de-recognize all the rulers. And that is when the erstwhile princes, led by Madhav Rao Sindhya, approached the Supreme Court. And the person whom we are honoring today, the late Nani Palkhiwala, argued their case. In a long judgment, several judgments, a dissent by a couple of judges, an 11-judge bench struck down the presidential order on a very narrow ground that the power of the president under Article 366, 22 of the Constitution to recognize a ruler cannot be used to de-recognize the institution of rulership altogether, because the institution of rulership was enshrined in the Constitution in Articles 291 and 362. The institution of rulership and the safeguard of privy purses was constitutionally enshrined, and therefore a presidential order could not have the effect of negating these articles of the Constitution. And in persuading the Supreme Court to strike down this presidential order, which incidentally was characterized by one of the judges as a fraud on the Constitution. May I pause here for a minute, Mr. Moderator, sir, and point out that the expression fraud on the Constitution is a well-known expression in constitutional litigation. It is necessary to emphasize this because just a couple of months back, a senior minister of the government expressed his regret that the Supreme Court, in one of its judgments, had used the expression fraud on the Constitution. But while holding this exercise of executive power as a fraud on the Constitution, the Supreme Court had occasion to dwell on the nature of the constitutional guarantees under Articles 291 and 362. And this was really the seed also of the basic structure argument which Mr. Palkhiwala later, 2 years later, persuaded the Supreme Court to accept. In Madhav Rao Sindhya, the Supreme Court, referring to these vital provisions, referring to the historical background and the constitutional context in which these provisions were introduced, described these provisions as integral to the Constitution. Honorable Moderator, sir, the word integral is one of utmost significance. Therefore, it is not the Privy Purses case, the Madhav Rao Sindhya case, which is commonly called the Privy Purses case, which was a constitutional betrayal. The first case was an affirmation of the Constitution. It is the sequel which led to a constitutional betrayal. 1971, the ruling party comes back with a huge majority and is able to get a constitution amendment passed, the Constitution 26th Amendment, which does away with Article 291 and 362, and so the constitutional guarantee for the status of rulers and their privy purses is taken away. Sir, the 26th Amendment, along with the 24th, 25th, and 29th Amendment, where the context in which the Keshavananda Bharatiya case was argued, where the Supreme Court laid down the basic structure doctrine for which the major share of credit goes to late Nani Palkhiwala and the late M.K. Nambiar. But having laid down the basic structure doctrine, the particular challenge to the 26th Amendment doing away with the privy purses came to be heard by the Supreme Court as late as in 1993. And this is where, Honorable Moderator, sir, the betrayal happens. The argument of Mr. Swarabji, a very eminent and himself legendary lawyer and someone who has learnt at the feet of Mr. Palkhiwala, was to use Mr. Palkhiwala's arguments in Madhavrao Sindhya and say the Supreme Court has said these articles are integral to the Constitution. If these are integral to the Constitution, then their removal must fall foul of the basic structure doctrine. And standard dictionaries were cited before the Supreme Court to indicate the meaning of integral. But the Supreme Court, in its judgment in Raghunath Rao, makes this distinction between integral on the one hand and basic and essential on the other, saying both are totally distinct and qualitatively different concepts. With respect, Honorable Moderator, sir, it is difficult to understand the logic of this distinction. It is also necessary to point out, sir, that just a few months later, after Raghunath Ganpat Rao, the Supreme Court was dealing with the second judge's case. And I quote a passage from the second judge's case. Rule of law is a basic feature Rule of law is a basic feature of the Constitution.
Mr. Raju Ramachandran, your time is over. Take 2 minutes, sir.
2 minutes more, sir.
Yeah.
Rule of law is a basic feature of the Constitution, which permeates the whole of the constitutional fabric and is an integral part of the constitutional structure. 6 months later, after Raghunath Rao Ganpat Rao, independence of the judiciary is an essential attribute of the rule of law. Honorable Moderator, sir, constitutional morality is woven into our constitution as the Supreme Court has now recognized. What happened to the princes is nothing but a violation of constitutional morality. Honorable Moderator, sir, a personal aside. I was not yet a law student. I was an undergraduate student. I would come to the Supreme Court to hear Mr. Palkhiwala argue Keshavananda Bharati. And I was there in his memorable closing address, where Mr. Palkhiwala ended by citing articles written by his towering opponent, Mr. H.M. Sirvai. Sir, it has fallen to the lot of a lesser lawyer like me to cite my eminent opponent, Mr. Aravind Datar, who says, the abolition of privy purses was a constitutional betrayal and must rank as one of the most shameful episodes in our constitutional history. I rest my case, sir.
Honorable moderator, sir, I must thank my opponent for the compliment towards the end. What I wrote is a view of mine, but it is necessary for the advocate to canvass the cause of his client irrespective of what he feels. And as an aside, when Mr. Palkhiwala quoted the statement of Sirvai, which was quite contrary to his plea in the Supreme Court, Mr. Sirvai took it very personally, and when I wrote this book, I interviewed a number of people. He didn't speak to Palkhiwala for several years, yeah, but I promised my friend that I will maintain my friendship. As the counsel for the Union of India, it is first necessary to put aside emotions, put aside our feelings, and take a clinical view of the subject. If what the government has done is permissible under the Constitution, then morality has no place there. If the Rajya Sabha resolution was defeated, but the government had the option of exercising powers through the President under Article 366-22, that also is perfectly valid. And I'll make good my submissions as to why the Sindhia judgment was clouded by emotional reasons. And what is worse is that the Sindhia judgment had not distinguished adequately binding precedents earlier on what is the nature of a privy purse, what is the role of Article 362, what's the role of Article 363. Before we start, we must first understand what is this privy purse we talk about. Now, when it was decided, the Indian Independence Act came and the princes had the right, the paramountcy lapsed. When they acceded to the Union of India, they were promised a privy purse. Now, how did they arrive at this amount of privy purse? They took a state, let's say Baroda, and they calculated the annual revenue of that state. Approximately 8.5% of the annual revenue of a state was paid to the prince as a privy purse for his personal expenses of him and his family. So out of the state's revenue of 100 rupees, 8.5 rupees was allocated to one family for their livelihood. My friend is wrong in saying that they gave up everything. If you see para 23 of the Madhura Sindhya judgment, the princes got not only the privy purse, plus no less than 34 different privileges, including exemptions from income tax, wealth tax, gift tax, estate duty, customs duty, and so on and so forth. They got a number of privileges. Now, the privy purse, which is 8.5% of the annual revenue of that state, and I must qualify it because out of 555 states, 450 states had revenues of less than 15 lakhs per annum. 12 states were paid large privy purse, not on the base 8.5%, but on an ad hoc basis. These are the large states, Hyderabad, Baroda, Mysore, Travancore, Cochin, and so on. But every ruler was given a privy purse, which was free from income tax. It was not guaranteed, as Mr. Bhatia will point out. He also was entitled to retain all his personal properties. All his personal assets, the palaces, the properties in their own name, continued to be retained by them. And my friend speaks about the prince's betrayal, but let us not forget that even though the privy purses went, all these rulers had their palaces, their lands, their other properties. And as all of us know, many of these properties became elaborate resorts and so on and so forth, earning good income. So it's not a case where a person was completely left on the streets, deprived of his livelihood. That would be a betrayal. But what happened was, just one component out of 35 components was taken away by the state. This is as far as the Privy purse is concerned. Now, the other thing you should note, as far as the Privy purse is concerned, is that my friend talked about post the Madras India judgment. Kindly note that after the Privy purse was abolished, Parliament, that is, we pass an act called the Recognition of the Rights of Rulers, Abolition of Privileges Act 1972. And in that act, even though we abolished the Privy purses in 1971, we gave them exemption from income tax on the income which they were earning from one particular source. The palace, the main building of theirs, was exempted from wealth tax. The entire jewelry of the family was completely exempted from wealth tax on one condition, that they could not take the jewelry outside India. That's all. All these exemptions continued. Now you've got a palace. You take the Baroda Lakshmi Vilas Palace in Baroda. It's 700-800 acres, 1,000 acres in the heart of Baroda. What is the value of that property? But even today it continues that income from house property of that palace, which is a notional income, is completely free of tax. So it can't be called a betrayal in that sense. Privy purse went, yes. But let us not forget that all these things have been continued by the government, and in that sense you can't strictly call it a betrayal. If you see the statement of objects and reasons signed by Mrs. Indira Gandhi to the 26th Amendment Bill, it says, it's a short statement of objects, it says it is proposed to abolish privy purses and abolish the privileges in relation to privy purses. All the personal rights, privileges, etc. continued, their personal property continued. And the Supreme Court has said that what is protected, what was taken away was some privileges, but the personal property of all the rulers continued. Now, this is the factual background which we have to note. Now we now go to the constitutional provisions of which my friend has not addressed. Was it permissible or was it not permissible under the Constitution? First of all, what is this privy purse? I mentioned how the privy purse was calculated. Now, my friend's clients themselves have argued before the Supreme Court that the privy purse is nothing but a political pension. That's what they argued, and it was accepted by the Supreme Court. If you take the case of Nawab Usman Ali in 1965, this worthy gentleman entered into a contract. There was a dispute. An arbitrator was appointed. The arbitrator passed an award against the Nawab. When the time came for execution, his senior counsel, Sri G.S. Pathak, who was the Vice President of India, took the plea that what is paid to the princes is nothing but a pension. Why is it a pension? Because it is the nature of a political pension, because it is paid periodically and it is given as some kind of a relief. The Supreme Court accepted that judgment, and accepted by J.C. Shah himself, who was in the Madras India majority, saying that a privy purse is nothing but a political pension, and the Nawab's, the award could not be executed under the political pension. Why? Because if it's a pension, under section 60, subsection 1, clause G of the CPC, pensions cannot be attached. So when an award was to be enforced against him, he takes the plea that it's a political pension, and that is upheld by the Supreme Court. Now, if the Supreme Court has held it's a political pension, how can it be a privilege, how can it be a constitutional right which amounts to a betrayal? I don't know. And this judgment has not been distinguished in the Madras India case. Now let's go to the other details of Article 291. My colleague will elaborate. And now I go to Article 360. There are four articles you have to bear in mind: 291, 362, 363, and 366.22. Now 362 says that the state shall have due regard to the rights, personal rights, privileges, and dignities of princes while framing laws. Shall have due regard. So when you're making a law, please keep in mind what are the covenants and treaties signed with the princes. Now the Supreme Court has itself said, in the case of Sudhanshu Shekhar Singh Dev from the ruler of Orissa, they said all these personal rights, privileges, etc., you have due regard. There is no obligation that you must comply with them. No obligation. Have due regard, but it is open to Parliament, open to the state legislature to go contrary to that. And what is more important is, a five-judge bench of the Supreme Court said that if a law is framed contrary to a personal right, personal privilege, rights and dignities of the rulers, it is non-justiciable. And that is the most important article, Article 363. And Madras India itself notes, this is the biggest hurdle we have to face and they overcome it, in my humble submission, wrongly. Now, in 1961, the Supreme Court said, even if a law is made contrary to your personal privileges, rights and dignities, it is non-justiciable, because Article 363 says, any dispute or any difference with regard to the covenants, agreements with the rulers, shall not be questioned in any court, including Supreme Court, High Court, the only exception if it's a presidential reference under Article 143. So when the Constitution itself has said that any dispute regarding a ruler, taking away his privy purse, taking away his privileges, cannot be decided by the court, and that is affirmed by a five-judge bench, where is the question of now coming to say that taking away privy purses, taking one of your 35 privileges, amounts to a constitutional betrayal? According to me, Sudhanshu Singh is a clear authority for the proposition that if any privilege is taken away, it cannot be questioned in any court of law. And incidentally, if you read Sudhanshu Shekhar, and aside when I mentioned properties, the facts of the case show that Sudhanshu Shekhar and his family had 42 villages, not lands, 42 villages. And one of his arguments was that these villages cannot be subject to income tax. All this income, agricultural income, should not be subject to income tax, because the Article 291 says income shall be free from all taxes. They said, no, you may be a ruler, but now you're a citizen. You pay income tax just as others pay. Only your pre-purse portion will not be liable to income tax. Everything else you earn will be as just as you are an ordinary citizen of the country. That's all, nothing more than that. But I only wanted to highlight that this thing that they were penniless, they were left on the streets, not correct, because one example is he had 42 villages and he argued that I gave 7 villages to my wife, so that income should not be clubbed in my hands. That also was completely rejected. Now, the other part of 363 is Savai Tej Singh Ji's case in 1979, the Raja of Alwar. If you see the covenants, if you see the various covenants with princes, there'll be one covenant regarding succession. Now, one thing don't forget, we have made provisions. The Hindu Succession Act does not apply to a ruler. Their succession will not go equally. There are no class A, class 1As and class 2As. Their succession is governed by their own rules of primogeniture, their own rules. That is protected, another privilege given to them. Now, in this case, the ruler, and the treaty will say, this is your right of succession, this is your privy purse, and these are all your properties, all listed in the covenants. Now, one dispute came as to whether a particular property was part of the list of properties or not. The Supreme Court, five judges, held that any dispute with regard to whatever is given to you under a treaty, even if it is taken away, government said it is not your property, it belongs to the state, we will not pay you the rent. They said it is not justiciable. So even a property held to be not his private property could not be decided by the court. I'm only emphasizing the fact that if the princes have lost their privy purse, they have no right. And there is a body of law called imperfect obligations. All of you are law students. You heard the word ubi jus, ubi remedium. Where there is a law, there is a remedy. But one exception in Samand is imperfect obligations, where rights are given to you, but if those rights are taken away, there is no remedy. My friend referred to the basic structure of the Constitution. Article 363 is there in the Constitution from day one. On 16th October 1949, T.T. Krishnamachari spoke, and one member asked him, suppose there is a dispute, where does the ruler go? That's the question put to him. And T.T.K. replies, we want to make it very clear that if there is any dispute with the ruler, the court shall have no jurisdiction. So my submission is 363 is part of the basic structure itself, because for everybody else, you can go under 226, go under 136, go under 32, but 363 starts the words, notwithstanding anything contained in this constitution, it overrides all other constitutional provisions, including 32 and 136. It may be harsh, but that is what the founders have done right from day one. And when TTK made the speech, his submission accepted, not a single member opposed that particular provision. Finally, I come to recognition and I conclude. 291 is on privy purses, 362 is having due regard to the privileges, 363 says not justiciable, and 366.22 talks of recognition. Now, what is this recognition? If you take section 311 of the Government of India Act, who is a ruler? A ruler has been defined in 311 of the Government of India Act to mean a ruler means a prince, a chief, or any other person recognized by His Majesty as the ruler. When the Constitution was framed, 366.22 said, ruler means a person recognized for the time being by the President of India. Now, why for the time being? Because there could be a dispute. And that came in the case of Kanwar Virendra Singh Ji, who was the Union of India in 1969. The Maharaja of Dholpur died without a male heir. His widow adopted a particular child, another child. Disputes came as to who will be the actual ruler. He said, I am the son of the uncle, therefore I should be the, take the gadi and I should be the ruler. The matter was referred to a committee of a chief justice and two other senior people, and they decided that this gentleman, this Rajendra Singh, is not the ruler. The ruler is some Hemant Singh. Now, the Supreme Court said, recognizing a ruler is a political act. It is not justiciable. The Supreme Court observed in para 9 that recognizing a ruler includes the power not to recognize a ruler. Now, if the Supreme Court says you cannot, it's up to the President to say, I'm not recognizing him as a ruler. That's the end of the matter. His Majesty could have done that. Now the President of India does that. So if derecognition of one prince is permissible, why not derecognition of all the princes? It amounts to the same thing. Now, these are my submissions, and I wanted to say, as far as Madhurav Sindhya is concerned, it is a judgment which should have taken note of these earlier submissions, earlier principles. What is a privy purse? Is it a political pension? If it's a pension, can it not be modified? Can it not be taken away? We talk of betrayal. Article 19.1G says I have a right to carry on business. Suppose my family is carrying on transport business. In many states, transport business is nationalized after the First Amendment. Is that a betrayal? It's a state policy. My family runs a liquor business. They impose prohibition. I can't carry on the business. Is that a betrayal? No. Now, just as you have the rights of princes, let us not forget our directive principles. Let us not forget Article 39B and C, which says we shall make sure that material resources are distributed for the common good and ownership is distributed for there is no concentration of economic wealth. Mr. Moderator, sir, my submission is, if we exclude emotion, if we exclude passion from the argument, strictly go by Article 291, 362, 363 and 366.22, the case is unarguable that this petition itself is not maintainable. We need not have had the trouble of going to the 26th Amendment and following later. And I'll only conclude by saying, borrowing the words of an American lawyer who said that when your case is weak on facts, you go to the law. When your case is weak on law, you go to the facts. And when you have no case on law or facts, you go to the Constitution of the United States. Thank you.
It has been suggested that that by the time of the 26th Amendment Bill, and certainly before that, by the time of the presidential order, despite the fact that the sovereignty of the rulers had been taken away, they were by no means penniless or left with without any wealth as such. And therefore, we cannot call this act a betrayal. I'd like to begin by addressing that particular fact. Now, the Supreme Court, in a series of judgments throughout the 60s, had noted the fact that these rulers who were given a particular status were not more equal than citizens in any way. In fact, in Madhav Rao Sindhya itself, the Supreme Court notes that the retention of the privy purse and certain associated privileges is only an accident of history. I would like to quote that particular paragraph. The rulers were left only a recognition of their original title, privy purse, their properties, and a few privileges. These rights were the only indicia of their former sovereignty, but they enjoyed them by the force of the Constitution, although in every respect they were ordinary citizens and not rulers. Now, currently an attempt has been made to club both the privy purses and the privileges, and thereby club both Article 362 and Article 291. Now, these were two distinct provisions which created two distinct kinds of rights and liabilities. Article 291, which protected the privy purse, was a guaranteed right, as opposed to Article 362, which merely said that the state shall have due regard to the privileges. There's a historical reason for this. The reason was that these privileges were sort of conceded by the Union of India so that a veneer of the erstwhile sovereignty can be retained in society. And the Union of India, while making the Constitution, was aware that this cannot be carried on in perpetuity. A distinction exists in the language of 291 of the Constitution, which says that the rulers, the erstwhile rulers, shall be guaranteed a privy purse, and that shall be a charge on the Consolidated Fund of India. Now, the argument that this was an imperfect obligation, therefore, was incorrect. And there is another historical reason for this. That is, between the agreements, the merger instruments, and the accession instruments, and the guarantee of this particular right in Article 291, there is a hiatus. The between 1947 and 50, the amounts which were to be granted, or immediately after the agreements were signed, the amounts to be granted to the rulers came from their respective states. When the Constitution was drafted, this was changed. It was made expressly a charge on the Consolidated Fund of India, and the only reference to the agreements, accession instruments, etc., were merely incidental. And that particular legal point, I would submit, gets this particular provision out of the bar of Article 363. Article 363 of the Constitution bars the interference by the Supreme Court or the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court only in such matters which directly arise out of the agreements or the instruments of accession. Article 291 not being such a provision, the inquiry into that particular matter was not barred, right? And in this connection, I would also draw the House's attention to the fact that in Madhav Rao Sindhia, the Supreme Court was cognizant of this distinction. The Supreme Court did not hold that as far as Article 362 is concerned, the court could have inquired into the issue. The court left that issue open and said that as far as 291 is concerned, there is no bar in Article 363. In any case, I would submit that the proposition before this House is not one of strict legality. The proposition before this House is that the abolition of privy purses was a constitutional betrayal. And I would point to the fact that the manner in which the privy purses was abolished is the real fact of betrayal. Now, as learned senior counsel who argued before me submitted before your lordships, this was before moderator, sir, it was purely a political move which was motivated by the political currents of the time. Now, essentially what had happened was in 1967, for the first time, Congress's vice-like grip over Indian electoral politics was challenged, and a number of victors from the opposition party were the erstwhile princes. Now, immediately there was a move by the Congress to adopt a form of populist socialism in which the privy purses were low-hanging fruit and the rulers were cast as the villains. Now, this particular approach was the real reason why the presidential order was moved in such haste, despite the fact that an amendment bill had been defeated by one vote in the Rajya Sabha. Now, this fact was particularly pointed out in the Rajya Sabha when Prime Minister Indira Gandhi moved this tersely worded bill, as Sri Aravind Datar pointed out. Now, in this surge of populist socialism, there were very few speakers to oppose this particular bill. This is a phenomenon that we see today as well. Now, the only speaker who spoke passionately against this was a gentleman named Dayabhai Patel, the son of Sardar Patel, who happened to be a Rajya Sabha member at that point in time. He noted, "The princes should have been persuaded to join and to sacrifice as they had done before. The government of India did this with open eyes in 1950. To repudiate it unilaterally is something which is not only repugnant but is immoral too." In conclusion, I would submit before this House, the fact is that at a time when it was convenient for us, we offered certain promises, we got something in return, we explicitly made it a part of the Constitution. Now, irrespective of whether it is a right or some kind of imperfect obligation, the fact is that without renegotiating that underlying compact, to unilaterally move a constitutional amendment and abolish these rights is not a fit act for a democratic state. There is only one word in the English language that describes such conduct. betrayal. Thank you very much.
Mr. Moderator, sir, members of the House, as the last speaker for the government, let me just draw our attention back to the title of the debate, which is that the final outcome in the Privy Persis case was a constitutional betrayal. And I would like to stress on the phrase constitutional betrayal, because logically something can be a constitutional betrayal only if it is in some way unconstitutional. And our submission on this side is that the petitioners cannot demonstrate the violation of any specific constitutional provision in this case. Now, my learned senior spoke to you about Articles 363, 362, and 366, Clause 22. And that leaves me the last article which is relevant, Article 291, which my learned opponent also spoke about. So let us begin by reading together Article 291. Article 291 states, where under any covenant or agreement entered into by the ruler of any Indian state before the commencement of this constitution, the payment of any sums free of tax has been guaranteed or assured by the government of the Dominion of India, such sums shall be charged on and paid out of the Consolidated Fund of India. Now, may I draw, Mr. Moderator, sir, your attention to the words under and has been guaranteed. The word under suggests that the source of the obligation is what follows immediately after, which is any covenant or agreement. And historically, what this refers to are the covenants of accession and merger that a number of princely states signed with the Dominion back then. And you see the privy purses first appearing in these instruments of merger and these covenants. So the source of the obligation is not the constitution, but pre-constitutional covenants or agreements. And the phrase has been guaranteed, which is in the past perfect tense, suggests an obligation that existed in the past and whose consequences continue in the future. That, Mr. Moderator, sir, leads us to understand that the way we interpret Article 291 is that the source of the obligation is in the covenant, the pre-constitutional covenants. Article 291 gives us the procedure or the method by which we implement those covenants or agreements, which is through a charge on the CFI. Therefore, Mr. Moderator, sir, what remains is this, that the constitution itself, so Article 291, contrary to both what the learned senior Mr. Ramachandran has argued and Mr. Shankar have argued, does not guarantee a privy purse. It only stipulates the method of implementation of that privy purse, whose guarantee lies in a source outside the constitution. Mr. Moderator, sir, this reading is buttressed by the debates in the Constituent Assembly. On 12th October 1949, well into the framing, Sardar Patel, in a speech on this very issue, made it clear, and if I may quote him, he said that the main part of our obligation under these agreements is to ensure that the privy purse at that time is paid. And by these agreements, he refers to the covenants of merger and accession. Mr. Moderator, sir, he could well have said our obligations under the Constitution. He chose not to, clearly indicating once more that the framers of the Constitution saw this as effectively a political agreement with the princes and not something under the Indian Constitution. And that was also made clear by Mr. Krishnamachari's speech, which my learned senior pointed out to. So, Mr. Moderator, sir, both the text of Article 291 and the debate show that 291 is not the source of the obligation. And this is further buttressed, Mr. Moderator, sir, by the judgment in Nawab Usman Ali Khan versus Sagarmal, which mentioned the privy purses as being political promises. Now, what was the basis of that finding in Usman Ali Khan's case? The court reasoned in that case that in view of the guarantee by the government of India to the ruler of Jawara state, in the covenant for the formation of the United States of Madhya Bharat, the payment of the sum specified in the covenant as privy purse became charged on the CFI. Mr. Moderator, sir, therefore it's clear that even the Honorable Court has held that the term charged in Article 291 does not create an obligation. It merely stipulates the procedure by which the obligation occurring outside the Constitution is to be implemented. Therefore, the text, the history, and precedents of this Honorable Court make it clear that insofar as the president acted in Article 6, Clause 22 of the Constitution, the president was not breaching any constitutional provision. Now, why is that important, Mr. Moderator, sir? That is important because the moment we agree that the source of the obligation is outside the Constitution, Article 663 kicks in. Article 663 makes it clear that if you want to implement anything in the covenant or agreement, in a covenant or agreement, then the jurisdiction of the courts is barred insofar as the obligation goes. And therefore, the burden upon the petitioners was to establish to this House that the source of the obligation lay within the Constitution. Because if it did not, then the bar under 363 would kick in very clearly. And it is our submission that the Article 291 and 362 together make it clear that that source lies outside the Constitution. Now, my lord, this Mr. Moderator, sir, my apologies. This was also made clear.
You are also saying this honourable court.
That honourable court decided the case back then. My apologies.
You have to say honourable Supreme Court.
The honourable Supreme Court. My apologies. My lord, Mr. Moderator, sir, in State of Gujarat versus Badruddin, the Badruddin case, similar facts where the princely state of Sant had some privileges granted to certain jagirdars with regard to certain forest produce. And when Bombay swallowed up the state of Sant during accession, when they were withdrawn, those privileges, the Honorable Supreme Court held that this is an act of state, and a successor state can elect whether or not to abide by it. Therefore, Mr. Moderator, sir, members of the House, in conclusion, there is no constitutional obligation to pay the privy purses. If there is no constitutional obligation, the question of a constitutional betrayal cannot arise. And as far as constitutional morality goes, first, that arises from constitutional provisions and does not exist independent of them. And secondly, if I may conclude by just saying, there are a number of values at stake here. One value, of course, yes, is keeping one's promises. We should all keep one's promises, that's very clear. But may I just leave you with this thought? There is another very strong value at stake here, which is that in a constitutional democracy that is committed to being equal and the rule of law and egalitarian and a welfare state, is any hereditary privilege that attaches simply by virtue of a person's status compatible with that constitutional order? And if that is not the case, then which value should prevail? I would leave you with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
As for the question whether morality can be a ground for violation of the basic structure, it was argued in Raghunath Rao, Ganpat Rao, the fact that a solemn promise had been made and the Union of India cannot be seen as perpetuating an immoral act should be taken into account while the violation of basic structure is tested. Now the court in responding to this particular contention, I think as in decided on the basis of certain obscure paragraphs from some jurisprudence textbooks to conclude that morality and legality are mutually exclusive domains. Now, this is a proposition that doesn't hold any longer with courts having repeatedly alluded to constitutional morality, though the extent to which we can test legislation or even constitutional amendments on that touchstone is still unclear.
Narula's case. Manoj Narula's case.
That's right. Now, therefore, but however, one hopes that as and when a question arises, whether a constitutional amendment has been moved in a manner which completely defies constitutional morality, one hopes that a court will now see it in different light rather than the way they saw it in Raghunath Rao, Ganpat Rao.
I think the question is, how was the privy purse computed in the treaties? If that's the question, I can add the opportunity of seeing a number of treaties, and in many treaties in Article 3 or Article 8 or 12 will decide the ruler for the time being shall be paid a privy purse of say 4 lakhs per annum. Then in some treaties they say the successor will get 2 lakhs per annum. The proposal was with each successive ruler the privy purse would keep on decreasing, and one of the arguments of Mr. Palkhewala was from 6 crores it had come to 4 crores, and even Granville Austen says that they should not have abolished it because in any case with passage of time it would have automatically got wiped out. But since I'm answering this question, there was no method. Now the out of 554 states, that 450 states, they took this 8.5% this thing.
I get this from V.P. Menon's book, Integration of States. He said broadly, when they did the treaties with various rulers, they tried to find out the annual revenues for 3 or 4 years, averaged it, and 8.5% of that was to be paid to the prince ruler for his personal expenses, for his family, etc. In some treaties, there is a unique provision. He gets a privy purse plus also marriage expense of his brothers and sisters. So there are some special provisions like that. But for the larger place, the biggest privy purse was to the Nizam of Hyderabad, who got 50 lakhs per year. Mysore got 26 lakhs, Travancore got 17, Jaipur got 18. And the lowest privy purse was the Raja of Kathodia, who got 192 rupees per year.
On the question of perpetuity, I think the text of Article 366, Clause 22, as unamended, answers the question, because that says that ruler in relation to any Indian state means the prince, chief, or other person by whom any such covenant or agreement as is referred to in Clause 1 of Article 291, which we discussed, was entered into and who for the time being is recognized by the president as the ruler of the state. So the phrase for the time being makes it very clear that it was never meant to exist in perpetuity. And I think that that actually shows that the institution of rulership, which is the submission that Mr. Ramachandran began with, could not possibly itself be part of the basic structure. And in concluding, Mr. Datar said that in the US there's a phrase that when you don't have the facts, you go to the law, and when you go to the law, you go to the facts, and when you have neither, you go to the constitution. I think in India, we should also have, when you have neither facts, nor law, nor constitution, you go to the basic structure. So I think that with that, I conclude.
But the better thing which I have heard about it is that if you are strong on facts, hammer the facts. If you are strong on law, hammer the law. And you are, if you are neither strong on law nor on facts, then hammer. Then hammer the table. So as per this program, I'm also given a chance to ask a few questions, two questions to each person. And what you had argued on that basis, I was thinking of these questions. So first question to Mr. Raju Ramachandran. You have, and Mr. Shankar Narayan emphasized it more, about the mel of IDs, that look, when the Rajya Sabha, it failed in Rajya Sabha, that too by one vote, and same evening, the president and that too sitting in Hyderabad passes this order, abolishing the privy purses, etc. Now, there are two aspects of which I want to ask. One is that the Supreme Court itself rejected the allegation of mel of IDs. So if that is rejected, will that be available to you in law to argue that when the mel of IDs are not established? Number two, in such measures, if as was pointed out by the other side and particularly Mr. Bhatia, saying if the act is constitutional, where's the question of mel of IDs? So what would be your answer to that?
Sir, my answers are these. The Supreme Court rejects mel of IDs, but the argument is that when you have tried to do indirectly what you could not do directly, because you saw the correct route as the constitution amendment route in 1970, you failed in that route and then passed the midnight order, that becomes vitiated by legal mel of IDs. That, sir, is my response to your first question. Your second question, sir, was with regard to the constitution amendment.
No. If the act is otherwise constitutional, which is other side asked, then the question of mel of IDs is irrelevant in this context.
My respectful answer, sir, is that if the constitution amendment itself, if the amendment to the constitution itself is in breach of the basic structure, and that is why I stressed on integral and basic. If certain provisions are integral to the constitution and part of the basic structure, then the fact that a constitution amendment is passed with the requisite majority, procedurally correct, etc., would not save that amendment from the vice of unconstitutionality.
I mean, your main premise,
sir,
of your entire argument was that it was an integral part and the basic structure doctrine. Of course, when Madhva Rao Sindhya judgment was given,
there was no basic structure doctrine.
Only the seeds were sown, as was rightly pointed out, and 2 years later in Keshwan and the Bharti, that was accepted. But when the second judgment came on this, and by that time, and the court has applied, and the court has said that it doesn't breach the basic structure, there is no. But here, my question is this: look, in the end, that is what is argued by, and that is the case of Union of India also. And that is why a very interesting question was also put to you, whether the giving of privy purse itself was not a betrayal of the constitution. Here, a constitution, and if we go to the preamble of the constitution also, we have decided to constitute a republic with socio-economic justice to the poor, and where everybody is equal. Article 14 is also there. Everybody is equal in the eyes of law. So therefore, making such a provision, would it not, and at that time in the context that yes, for them to secede their power and become a part of the union was entirely a political decision, and going by the ethos of the constitution, could not there be another political decision to divest them of this? And when we go by the, and which are again the basic structure of the constitution.
So that the basic structure comprises, for the present purpose, equality and republicanism. It is in that context.
In a democratic society, and democracy is also a part of basic structure.
Sir, these concepts are not concepts which do not accommodate recognition of historical facts which do not dilute true equality. Just as, sir, today in the context of Article 370, the question comes of special provisions. Just as our federation, our federal arrangement admits of asymmetrical federalism and special status, whether to Jammu and Kashmir or to the northeastern states. Similarly, my respectful answer is giving respect and recognition to a historical contribution does not in any manner militate against these fundamental tenets of either equality or republicanism.
Okay, thank you. I have to ask you also two questions. Article 14. Now the first is on Article 363. Your entire case was based on, or most of it is based on, that it is, these are imperfect obligations and therefore unenforceable in law and political decision in that matter, and therefore the court could not have gone into this at all. If you see the judgment which is given in Madhva, so the Supreme Court has held that look, when the right is given in the constitution itself, how it can be treated as imperfect?
So first of all, as Mr. Bhatia pointed out, the right was not given in the constitution. It was a guarantee given under the treaty, which was then recognized by the constitution and given. So there was no constitutional right. That was also one of the arguments of Mr. Nirande at that point of time. Secondly, my submission is this: as far as assuming it's a right under the constitution, if it's not part of the basic structure, it can be taken away. A right can be given, it can be taken away. Now, if you've got a right to carry on business, it can be taken away. At a legislative level, a promise is made, it can be taken away. There's no promissory estoppel against the legislature. So my submission is, assuming 291 is a constitutional right, you have enjoyed the privy purse for 25 years. Parliament decides to take away the privy purse alone. It doesn't touch with your other asset, doesn't touch. In fact, up to Ganpat Rao, which came in 1994, none of the princes were able to establish that taking away the privy purse has left them with huge losses, or they were completely deprived of their liberty, livelihood, and nothing. It was basically a legal argument that I lost my privy purse. So my submission is, your answer would be, your question is perfectly valid. If they had taken away everything lock, stock, and barrel, then you could have argued that, look, there's some element of Article 21 involved, basic structure involved, and so on. But if only one, and as the cost of repetition, out of 35 privileges, including privy purse, only privy purse was taken away after 25 years, then I don't think there could be violation of the basic structure, even assuming it was part of the constitution itself. And as you also suggested, society, like Justice Holmes said, everything is, you see, a felt necessity of the times. Suppose after 25 years you feel what was good in 1950s, not good in 71, not good in 75, not good in 80. The people can say, and by the time the 26th Amendment came, the party had got the two-thirds mandate. And the party decided on terms of this mandate, let us amend the constitution and say there will be no concept of privy purses, but in must say in fairness, they stuck only to the privy purse and did not touch the other assets. In fact, they protected it by passing a 1972 Act. Thank you.
Now, on that second question, which on this only, which actually you have said yourself, if you go to the historical background, which was highlighted by the other side, that look, they were the rulers. They were sovereign. They themselves were sovereign at that time. And they enjoyed that powers of sovereignty. And they gave away that. And they became a part of the union. And in this historical background, when the constitutional provision is made, if we go by the theory of originalism in construing the constitution, then what would be your answer, then how it has to be dealt with?
It's a very important question. First of all, I want to clarify that in Nawab Usman Ali Khan's case, there's another Nizam Hyderabad's case, the question came as to, in international law, what is the status of these princely states? And the Supreme Court held that, referring to international law textbooks, they said these princely states were not sovereign states as in the nature of an independent country. They were having in international law the status of protected states. They were vassals, V-A-S-S-A-L, they were vassals of the British Crown. They were subject to suzerainty of the British Crown. So they could not be called sovereign in the international law sense. They were only protected states, they were protectorates. So they cannot claim the status of that, and that was held in Nawab Usman Ali Khan's case.
Okay. Thank you. You see, I think in these four questions, in a way, I have, by putting these questions, what was in my mind as far as the two, it was a case in 1970s which ultimately finished in the second, in 1994, with the second judgment, raised very interesting questions about constitutionalism as well. Of course, nowadays, all these concepts have been refined and they are coming in a much better way, the way constitutional is developing in various other countries also, and the way we are adapting some of these good principles in the interpretation of this our constitution as well. And it raised many, many questions which are still debatable. All the issues which are coming up before the Supreme Court, which came in last 3-4 years, and the kinds of issues which we are dealing with, that take it 377, take a triple talaq case, and the transgender matters. You see, these are the matters, I would say, when they have the moral overtones also. They have, and some of these matters are there in the in a democratic setup, in our where the public will have divided opinion as well, whether it is on the ground of morality or it is on the ground of democratic principles. So ultimately, and it has political overtones as well. So all these things are combined, and it becomes, I can say from my experience, sometimes it becomes, and they throw a very, very big challenge to the Supreme Court to decide such matters, if it is purely legal. So ultimately, at the end of the day, the Supreme Court has to go by the spirit of the Constitution. And as was said in the beginning, rather by Mr. Datar, that we have to keep the emotions apart and we have to see what the law is, where the law is going, and have to decide the cases accordingly. I will say that much only, as well as you said that I will be giving my main lecture also. I was not told about it, number one. Number two, there's no time, but I promise I'll write one lecture and give it to you so that it can be published. Thank you.